To destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The Gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
To the great King David, Nathan the prophet said, "You are the man." 2 Samuel chapter 12. Welcome to our study of the books of the Old Testament. Today, as we think about 2 Samuel, we further see God's reign in Israel, but more importantly, we think about David as king of Israel, and ultimately how Christ would come through David and reign over the Lord's church today as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Revelation 19, verse 16. Now, just some background information about 2 Samuel. At the close of 1 Samuel, Saul, the king, dies. And in his place now, David, man after God's own heart, is going to be placed as king over Israel, and this will be one of the most prosperous reigns in all of Israel, because for the most part, David tries to follow God and do the right thing. Now, as it relates to 2 Samuel, the key chapter is going to be chapter 11, where David sins with Bathsheba. He sees her bathing, he desires her, he takes her for himself, has relations with her, and because of that action, bad things begin to occur in the kingdom of Israel and in the life of David. Now, the key phrase, as we mentioned, 2 Samuel 12, verse 21, is such a practical principle for all of us. Nathan, in confronting David, said, "You are the man." As it relates to sin, that's something all of us need to hear. I have sinned. If Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, then friend, I can say I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I need the grace of God to be saved. Titus 2 verse 11. I need the gift of God's Son. John 3:16. And I am in desperate need of God's blood, Jesus' blood, to be cleansed from sin. 1 John 1 verses 7 through 10 and Romans 6 verses 1 through 4. Now, as we think about 2 Samuel, just kind of a key overriding verse that illustrates God's blessings on those who do right is found in 2 Samuel 22, verse 21. Listen to these words. David says, "The Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands, the cleanness of my hands, He has recompensed me." As we think about God's principle of doing right and being blessed, this is found throughout Scripture. David says, and he had to look back on some events that he necessarily didn't like, and he says, "The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness. He's repaid me according to the good things that I've done." Friend, the Scriptures teach that if we do right and we live right, God's going to take care of us. Matthew 6:33, Jesus said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and all His righteousness, and all these things shall be given unto you." If I put God's kingdom, God's righteousness, and God's will first in my life, then friend, you can be sure God is going to do His part and take care of you. Remember Philippians 1:21? Paul said, "For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Look at Paul's life. Were there temptations? Absolutely. Was there persecution? On every hand, it seemed like. But did Paul ultimately receive the victory? Paul said in Romans 8, verse 18, "I consider the sufferings of this present time, they're not even worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Absolutely, Paul could say, "Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And so, as a central message, 2 Samuel kind of further illustrates, even in the good King David, it further illustrates the failure of a human king in helping Israel to please God. Did Israel need a king? God said in Hosea 13:11, "I gave him a king in my anger and took him away in my wrath. In the book of 1 Samuel, God said to Samuel, when the people asked for a king, they said, they've not rejected you, God said, they've rejected me. They didn't need a king because God was already king. He was already on the throne. And as you study 1 Samuel through 2 Chronicles, you will see time and time again, even with the best of kings, that their aid was really not that great in helping Israel to please God. And thus, here's the application. When life's going good, when we're prospering, when God's blessing us, friend, we need to realize these are sometimes the very times when Satan finds a way to work in our lives. Things are going great for David. So much so that during time of war, he even stays home. Everything's looking great in the kingdom. His reign is going well. He begins to let his guard down and relax. That's the moment Satan finds a hole into his life. Thus, I must realize the aggressive and militant nature of our enemy and our foe. The Bible says, be sober, be vigilant. Don't let your guard down. Be alert, be aggressive, for your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Now, let's make some practical lessons through the book of 2 Samuel, and let's begin by asking why. Why did God allow a king? If we've noted, and it's true, God says they've rejected me, I gave him a king in my anger. If God was already king, why did God allow them to have a king then? Well, several reasons come to mind, and first is this. Sometimes, whether we need it or not, we get what we ask for. Did you always need what you asked for as a child? Well, you might have asked for frivolous things. And in getting those, maybe you realized, hey, this really wasn't what I needed. Sometimes God allowed the people of Israel to have what they wanted so that they could learn a lesson from that. And the lesson, I think, as you look at all these kings, the lesson, one of the overriding lessons is, we need to trust God, not men. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. As we think about why God gave them a king, also it helped the people to realize their dependence upon God. Who fed them? Who gave them rain from heaven? Who was it that really defeated their enemies? When they started to put their trust in men, that'd be the moment they would go downhill. They needed to realize it was God who gave them everything. The same is true for Christians. James 1:17 says, every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no shadow or variation of turning. I need to realize my total dependence must be on God. I must ask, I must seek, I must do His will, and then I know God will take care of me. But then a third reason why God gave them a king is simply to bring Christ into the world. Was it ultimately God's will? God worked through it. God used what the people asked for, and God used that to bring His Son, Jesus Christ, into the world. Is Jesus the perfect king? Absolutely. Unlike David, unlike good kings throughout Israel, Jesus never sinned. Hebrews 4:15 says, He was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. He committed no sin, nor guile or deceit was not found in His mouth. 1 Peter 2, verses 21 and 22. Jesus is that perfection of what a king ought to be. And friend, He's still reigning over the Lord's church today. He is seated at the right hand of the throne on high. Hebrews 1, verse 4. He is the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. Revelation 19, verse 16. And thus, ultimately, God used this plan to bring His Son into the world. Now let's make some practical application from the book of 2 Samuel of this Old Testament book. The Bible says of the Old Testament in Romans 15:4 that the things were written aforetime were written for our learning. What lessons can I learn that will impact my life in the New Testament today from the book of 2 Samuel? Well, from 2 Samuel chapter 6, we learn the results of disobedience. Do you remember what was going on in 2 Samuel chapter 6, the context? The ark is being brought back to the people, being brought back to Jerusalem, and the Bible tells us that they put this ark on a new cart. And as they are crossing this this road, as they're going through on the road through Nashon's threshing floor, the Bible says, that the ark became a little tipsy maybe. It began to fall. And so two men were driving that cart, Ahio and Uzzah. And of these two men, Uzzah reaches out. As the ark of God begins to fall, he knows what it represents. He loves the ark of God. He loves God. And so he reaches out to steady that ark. What happened then? The Bible tells us in 2 Samuel 6, he dropped dead right there on the spot. David became angry. He didn't know why these things happened at that time. Why is it that a man who was trying to preserve the ark of God, trying to help God and help the people get it back, why is it that he died right there on the spot at the hand of God? Friend, this is a clear example of the result of disobedience, even when it's not intentional. Now, sometimes we need to look a little at the rest of the Bible and look a little further to kind of get the rest of the story as to what happened with Uzzah and the transporting of the ark in the Bible. The rest of the story found concerning the transporting of the ark is mentioned to us in the book of Chronicles, 1 Chronicles chapter 15, beginning in verse 13. I want you to hear and understand why Uzzah had to die in that context. Listen to 1 Chronicles 15. For because you did not do it the first time, the Lord our God broke out against us, listen, because we did not consult Him about the proper order. Now, what do you mean, David? So the priests and the Levites sanctified themselves to bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel, and the children of the Levites bore the ark of God on their shoulders by its poles, as Moses had commanded according to the word of the Lord. As you read Exodus and Numbers, there were specific guidelines already given for transporting the ark. Only the sons of Kohath could do it. They had to run poles through rings in the ark, and they were only to transport it on their shoulders. Nobody was ever to touch it. Now, had the people in the time of David in 2 Samuel 6 done that, would the ark have got a little lopsided or tipsy? Not at all. That was God's perfect way to transport it. And when they did something else, and when they violated God's command that no one was to touch it, they had to suffer the consequences. Uzzah dying there is a result, a direct result of disobedience, even when it was unintentional. Friend, I must understand and learn from this that God expects me and He expects you to obey Him. Jesus said in Matthew 7:21, it's not everybody that looks up into heaven and says, Lord, Lord, that's going there, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Jesus asked a haunting question to the Jews in Luke chapter 6, verse 46. He said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? Do you remember Hebrews 5, verses 8 and 9? The Bible says Jesus is the author of eternal salvation to all who obey Him. Must I obey God? Absolutely. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. John 14, 15. Well, what's going to happen if I don't obey God? Oh, something far greater than Uzzah dropping dead will happen. The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 1, verses 7 through 10, that one day the Lord will be coming in flaming fire to take vengeance on those who do not obey God, those who do not know God, and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so we learn a very practical lesson about making sure that we obey God, not men's ideas, not men's teaching, but that we go to the Bible and we simply obey God. You know, from the book of 2 Samuel, we also learn a powerful prophecy and lesson about the kingdom. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 7, and I want you to look at the promise and the prophecy that is made here. The Bible says in 2 Samuel 7, verse 12, God is giving His covenant through David. God says, when your days are filled, speaking to David, are fulfilled, and you rest with your fathers, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body. I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. God says, I'll be his father. He shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rods of men and with the blows of the sons of men. Here you've got the king and the kingdom in prophecy. God says to David, after your time, when your days are gone, when you're in the grave, I'm going to set up a king and a kingdom after you. Of that man's kingdom, there'll be no end. Now, I understand that Solomon, as well as you, that Solomon followed David and that he reigned over the kingdom of Israel. But has Solomon's kingdom ended? Well, sure it is. When Solomon died, that kingdom and his kingship ended. Well, who is this that's being spoken of as having a kingdom that will never end, that will reign over the house of God forever? I want you to notice Luke chapter 1, and I want you to hear the words. These are so similar to the words given to David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 12. Listen to Luke chapter 1, the prophecy made to Mary, beginning in verse 32. The Bible says of Jesus, He will be great. We'll be called the Son of the Highest. The Lord God, listen, will give Him the throne of His father David. He'll reign over the house of Jacob forever. And here's that statement. And of His kingdom, there'll be no end. Like the promise made in 2 Samuel 7, verses 12 and 13, here you've got the fulfillment of it in Jesus Christ. Jesus was of the lineage of David. Matthew chapter 1 teaches us that. He is of the tribe of Judah, Hebrews 7, verse 14, and we've already seen. He's King of kings and Lord of lords. And so all the way back in the book of 2 Samuel, we've got proof positive. Jesus is King of that eternal kingdom of which there'll be no end, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, Matthew 16, verses 18 and 19. Now, as we think about practical lessons that we can learn from 2 Samuel, let's turn our attention to David's ultimate failure in 2 Samuel chapter 11. I want you to notice some of these words with me. As we think about what David was doing, here's what's going on at the time. The Bible says in 2 Samuel 11, verse 1, it happened in the spring of the year, at the time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the people of Ammon and besieged Rabbah, but David remained at Jerusalem. And so, first off, we realize David is really maybe not where he ought to be. Time when kings usually go out to battle, David's not there. His people are. They're winning battles, but what's David doing? Well, let's look a little further in 2 Samuel chapter 11. Notice verse 2. Then it happened one evening that David arose from his bed, walked on the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful to behold. So David sent and inquired about the woman. Here we see David, not really where he ought to be, and one night it looks like he can't sleep, and so David arises. He doesn't know what to do, so he goes up on the rooftop, and there, in a moment of idleness and likely a moment of weakness, David beholds beautiful Bathsheba. There she is bathing and her beauty is seen by him. And so he inquires, who is this woman? Now, what happens next is when the sin begins to occur. David saw that, but acting on that is when things begin to get difficult and sin enters in for David. Notice 2 Samuel chapter 11, and I want you to look at what is said beginning in verse 3. So David sent and inquired about the woman, and someone said, is that not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? Then David sent messengers and took her, and she came to him, and he lay with her, for she was cleansed from her impurity, and she returned to her house. And the woman conceived, so she sent and told David and said, I am with child. Look at the sin that has now entered into God's kingdom through a human monarch. He sees this beautiful woman bathing. He then acts on that, finds out who she is. Since he's the king, he can pretty much do what he wants, he thinks. And so he sends for her. He knows she's married. He lies with her, has relations, and she becomes pregnant. Now there's a big problem that David has to deal with. He has broken the law of God. He has committed adultery, and now he has another man's wife pregnant. What is David going to do? Is he going to repent? Is he going to own up to it? Is he going to step down from being king? That isn't the course of action that he takes. Now David begins to weave a tangled web of sin. He first begins to think, maybe people will think that this is her husband's baby. And so he calls the husband in, Uriah, from the battle, sends him home to his wife, thinking to himself, maybe they'll have relations and everybody will think this is their child. Uriah is more noble than that. How can he be home with his wife when people are in battle dying? And so he doesn't even begin to do that. David then begins to think, what else can I do? Well, I've got to rid the problem, he says. And so he tells his commander, in the heat of battle, when your fiercest opponents are there, you send Uriah out and you pull back, have him murdered, basically. That's what happens. And so now David thinks he's got the problem solved. He can now legally, rightfully take her as his wife, he thinks, but he's yet to see the sin in the matter. Let's hear it from Nathan's standpoint in 2 Samuel chapter 12. Listen, beginning in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, and he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man, had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had brought up and nourished. It grew up together with him, with his children. It ate of his own food, drank from his own cup, lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man, who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who'd come to him, but he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for him, for the man who'd come to him. Now watch David's response. So David's anger was greatly aroused against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, whoever the man who has done this is shall surely die. Now, you can see the tenderness in the story. Here's a rich man. He's got a lot of flocks. He's got a lot of herds. He has a visitor come one day. And so instead of taking something from his own herd to kill and slaughter for this man to eat, what does he do? Well, there's this poor man. And he's only got one little ewe lamb. And it's been like a child to him almost. It's raised with his children. It ate out of his own hand. It slept in his own bed. It was close, very close to the man. It was all he had. What does the rich man do? Instead of taking from his own flocks, he takes this one ewe lamb that this man loves. It's all he's got. And he slaughters it for this stranger that's come to visit. David gets the point. He says, that's an injustice. He shouldn't have done that. That was wrong. Whoever's done this, David says, is deserving of death. Now watch how it becomes personal. 2 Samuel 12. Look again in verse 5. David's anger was greatly aroused against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die. He shall restore fourfold for the lamb because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. At that point, David began to realize exactly what he had done. He was that rich man. In the story, he represented the rich man. He had the host of flocks. He had multiple things he could have done other than take Bathsheba as he already had a wife. He didn't need to do that. And yet Uriah, he represents that man who didn't have that, who loved his wife, who that's all that he had. He didn't have all the choices that David had. And so David at that point realized, you're right. I am the man. Well, what did David do from that point out? David said, I've sinned. You read Psalm 51, and it is a great psalm of David's contrition and repentance. I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I've done this great wickedness, David said. He at this point becomes tender again. He realizes he's made mistakes. He repents, and from this point on, he begins to make it right with God. Friend, if there's a practical lesson we learn from 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12, it is, instead of trying to hide sin, we need to deal with it properly. Proverbs 28 verse 13 says, he who covers his transgression will not prosper. He who forsakes and seeks mercy, that's the person who will really prosper. As long as David was trying to hide it, there was going to be problems, especially in his own life. How true that is for each of us. Instead of trying to hide sin, instead of trying to avoid it, overlook it or deal with it in some other way, like David, I've got to say, I've sinned. like Saul, who said, I've sinned, I've erred exceedingly, I've played the fool, I need to realize in my own life there are times where I've got to come face to face with sin. Remember Romans 3:23? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Friend, that's personal, because if all have sinned, I've sinned. There is none righteous, no, not one. Romans chapter 3 in verse 10. Well, today in the New Testament, what does a person do to overcome the sin problem? We've noted that you've got to recognize sin, but you must do more than that. You've got to go to the right source for the cure from sin. The Bible says you first must hear the Word of God. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Once you've heard that Word, you must recognize Jesus is the only way a man can be saved. John 8:24, Jesus said, unless you believe that I am He, you will surely die in your sins. Having believed, a person must repent of sin, must turn from sin and turn to God. Jesus said in Luke 13:3, unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. Peter preached on in Acts chapter 3, directly after the first gospel sermon, Peter preached, repent and turn again that your sins may be blotted out. Repentance is a 180-degree turn from a life of sin to a life of seeking to do the will of God. Then you've got to make that good confession. Romans 10 verse 10 says, with the heart, with the mind, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Then having done all that, you must be baptized in water for the forgiveness of sins. On that great day of Pentecost, in Acts chapter 2, when they realized they'd killed their own Messiah and they cried out, men and brethren, what shall we do? Here was the answer. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. Friend, if you've never done those things, today we ask you, why not? Will you today obey God's plan of salvation? We want you to know that the God of heaven wants nothing more than for you to become a child of His. We hope you'll continue with us as we study more from these Old Testament books. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your own.
Like a thief in the night, and he will.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials, as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905, or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
Be the glory, and to God be the glory. This is the gospel of Christ.